Good evening, YouTube. I have some good news. I've started making videos again. I'm not counting this one because this one is very, very easy to make, but I do have three other ones in the work that are going to be more complicated and on more serious issues. So stay tuned. They should be out by December. In the meantime, while I'm still struggling with my latest college semester, I thought I'd start a simple series on something I've grown more interested in. The hardware of video games. This is the introduction to the series, and I'd like to hear your input on how I should create more. I have a large selection of video game consoles from third generation to the seventh generation, as well as various peripherals. So I decided I'd start off with the section of Nintendo cartridges. Unfortunately, I have no more Segas. I used to have a Sega Master, but my mom threw it away when I was in middle school because it was old, and I shouldn't have old systems. But that's a story for another day. So, first off, let me turn the screen around so I see what I'm pointing at. Oh, there we go. I start off with possibly the most famous cartridge that exists, the launch title for the NES, Mario Brothers Duck Hunt. I put some stars on it when I was 6 years old. I don't know why. But anyway, first off, I'd like to say that although I've dismantled these, I haven't damaged the casing or the cartridges in any way, so don't worry about that. Everything's still fine. The NES has a 1.66 megahertz processor, and 2 kilobytes of RAM. Now, to put that in perspective, my 5-year-old tower, it has a 2.8 gigahertz quad core, so multiply that by 4. And it has 12 gigabytes of RAM. So not much power in the NES. Now, this cartridge here, it looks pretty big, but there's actually not much to it. This is Mario Duck Hunt. Doesn't even use all of the pins. So one side is, so this is, all it is just the ROM chips that store the permanently embedded code. However, the game manufacturers wanted more to work with. So Nintendo began allowing the creation of additional hardware. The nice thing about cartridges is that unlike optical media, CDs, DVDs, Blu-ray discs, and modern systems, the cartridges are essentially an expansion card. They become part of the system. So it's possible to expand on the existing hardware by adding more hardware to the actual game cartridge, starting with this first Mega Man game. Yeah, it looks nothing like what Mega Man looks like. It's probably some of the worst box art ever. Now, you see here, besides having extra RAM, some games had as much as 1 megabyte of RAM on board, which is substantially larger than the 0.02 megabytes of RAM that was on the NES. Wait, 2 kilobytes? 0.002, because it's 1,000 times as much. Man, I shouldn't have done this video at 12 o'clock in the morning. Now, when I opened this, what I found really surprised me is this chip right here, the 748HC32. I actually use circuit chips like that in my hardware class. It's called an OR gate. It has 6 OR gates on it. I'll put some diagrams in the overlay on the screen, how that works.
But basically, but this is a very simplistic, this is a single logic unit. I've actually assembled more complicated logic circuits than what's in this game. And this is an expansion to the game's abilities. This is another logic circuit. I'm not exactly sure what it does. I don't know, maybe it's an I don't think it's an exclusive OR. But anyway. Basically what this means is you have in six places you have two inputs and one output. So there's your two inputs for one and an output. No, those are the two inputs and that's an output. That's voltage and that's the ground. Or one or both of those is either a positive or zero. And if it's either one of them or both of them are positive, then it's going to output a positive value. If neither of them are positive, it's going to output a zero value, which is opposed to if this was an AND gate, then the only times it would output a positive value is if both of them were positive. And that's all it is. That was enough to help add some expanded abilities to the NES. Future Mega Man games came with more and more complicated chips, they started using more advanced hardware add-ons in future games. Like this one in Super Mario Bros. 2 was also used in Super Mario Bros. 3 and Mega Man 3, and this is the third generation memory management controller. So this allowed the use of additional RAM. And not only additional RAM, but RAM for dedicated purposes. So you had RAM for backgrounds and RAM for character displays. It made scrolling a lot easier. So, all right. Now I'm gonna go, the reason why I saved the name. What's this? The reason why I saved this one for last is because it had something extra special in it. The Legend of Zelda, this shiny gold cartridge. Now this one here has the memory management controller generation 1, but it also, so it's, it allows for additional memory control, memory being RAM, but it also has a battery, and this because the RAM used in these cartridges is volatile memory, so it's just like the RAM that's in your computer. And RAM can only save data if it has power. Once it loses power, it loses all of its saved data. So I've tested this on my NES. Played it for a while. The battery still works fine. This game is made in 1985. It's older than I am, but the battery is still has a sufficient charge to keep the RAM from losing its data. Unfortunately, with these RAM chips, is that they have a tendency to corrupt the saved data if they crash while playing. All right, so that's the NES cartridges that all the examples of their hardware I have. Now I'm going to move on to the Super NES.